Again, my name is Dan Wakend. I'm from IBM. I've been with IBM for about 20 years, and I'm an offering manager and own some of our IT operations analytics portfolio. And one of the things that we've been doing for a while now is working very closely with Splunk and bringing helping bring our customers like Harry and Rabobank visibility into the mainframe. So just the standard slide that's forward-looking statements. I don't think we have anything in the presentation that's forward-looking. I don't think there's anything predictive in what we're going to show. But so getting started, and really I just want to spend a few minutes on what we're doing and why we're doing. At IBM, we like to talk about the digital transformation and really why it's important to the core of our business. So we're really going from where the mainframe has kind of been sitting there on the side processing a bunch of transactions. And if you stop by the IBM booth, you saw the big letters open and connected. It's really how we're seeing an explosion of transaction growth as we go and access the mainframe. So it's the pervasiveness of mobile devices and laptops and mobile computing. I know I have my phone and I go and deposit checks to my bank, where before I had to go to a teller and go and do that stuff. So all of those things are interacting with how we do and interact with the mainframe. Just like I know probably a bunch of you that have flights later today went and checked in online on your phone. Again, going back through and the mainframe. It's really something that is sitting there that a lot of folks don't realize is there, that's still driving what we do for the global economy. So as we do that, we can't have the processes that we used to have where it took us 6 months, a year to go and develop and roll out new processes on the mainframe. Our lines of businesses and our services that we're offering are really demanding that we do a lot of things more quickly so they can keep up and ahead of the market with their customers. And as a result, and why we partnered with Splunk, is we really need to bring visibility into what's going on in the mainframe in real time. And we have a couple of great solutions that we have from the IBM side. We're going to focus on one of those today on how we get IBM Z operational data into Splunk. So just a quick show of hands, how many in here kind of know what a mainframe is but don't really have a lot of insight into what it is? Okay, so probably roughly a third to a half are folks. So I'm actually pretty new to the IBM Z organization. I've been with them for about 2 years. So I always like to talk about this slide, especially in a room like this, just the importance of what the mainframe and what it brings to the global economy. In business transactions that run on the mainframe per day. So there's a runtime on IBM Z. A lot of the mainframe folks in the audience will know Kix. There's roughly 1.3 million Kix transactions that run worldwide every single second. So think about that, in 1 second, 1.3 million transactions that run. So how many folks, quick show, how many, or someone shout out a number, how many Google searches happen in that same second worldwide? Anyone have an idea? So someone probably did a Google search on their phone, but worldwide, 68,000, just over 68,000 Google searches run every single second. So 20 times more transactions run on the mainframe and just in Kix alone every second compared to what happens in Google, something that everyone knows and can relate to. I know I've run a number of searches on Google today and myself went and checked into my airline and all that stuff. So really it shows the power of what IBM Z is. The other thing is that from a financial standpoint, when I go and buy a cup of coffee or lunch, swipe my credit card, it adds up to a pretty astounding number, $7.7 trillion in credit card payments processed annually on IBM hardware. So if you compare that to world GDPs, it would rank third. So behind the US and China, so just ahead of Japan. So really a lot of power that really drives the global economy. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Harry and let him talk about Rabobank and how they're leveraging the mainframe and solutions from IBM.
Okay, thank you, Dan. My name is Harry. I work for Rabobank. I'm in, let's say, in IT since 85, for quite a long time. I always work with mainframes, so that really is my passion. In short, something about Rabobank. Rabobank is not going to tell too much about it because it's just a bank and we transfer money from one account to another account. But we are really moving from our current model with our own products to a more open banking model. And our ambition is, our vision is phrased in five ambitions. And one I want to lift out of it, that we are really doing a lot on innovation and new technologies. So a few years ago, the Rabobank decided to migrate the payment system. So we are migrating from our HP non-stop systems to a Linux environment and the mainframe. Therefore, we choose what should be landing on the Linux environments and what on the mainframes. And we say, okay, what we know about the mainframe is that it is a robust environment. The Linux environments, our front-end applications, need a lot of flexibility. So they land on the Linux environments. Our back-end needs more robustness, less flexibility, but it must be always on. It must be secure, reliable, a lot of transactions going on there, thousands of seconds. So it must be solid as a rock. And that is why Rabobank said, okay, for that type of applications, the mainframe is our strategic environment. One of the things that comes with the mainframe is that it's often seen as a very isolated environment. It's an isolated platform, and it can't work with anything around it. So it's some machine that's running somewhere in the basement with some people who are doing some work, but nobody knows what they are actually doing. So one of the goals we have is to become more transparent. We want to be part of an end-to-end world. We want to be more part together with the distributed environments. And that means we need to become more transparent and more open. We are now opening up our mainframe with services, with web services, with REST API, so we can really connect with the other environments. Another main thing we are working on is we are automating really everything. So we are adopting the DevOps very fast. We're doing a lot in that way. We are able to provision complete environments within minutes with one push on the button, and a complete environment for people who know about Kix regions and transaction servers is 26 Kix regions in a KixFlex environment. We do that in a few minutes. So every team, the goal is that every team, every DevOps team in our organization must be able to be fully self-supporting. They must be able to push on the button, say, get an environment. They must be able to automatically deploy all the applications they write to that environment and also fill the complete environment with the needed test data and run automatic testing. So that's one side we are fully automating now. The other side we are working on is, let's say, self-tuning, self-managing systems. So we are working together with IBM to see how can we make DB2 more self-managing, more self-tuning. And that's an area where artificial intelligence and that kind of stuff pops up. So we are doing a lot of things with the mainframe. And so it is, for us, it is really a strategic platform. So now back to the story where we're here for. What I would try to tell the story more starting from a high level and then drill down a little bit more and more with architecture and to the components, common data provider and Splunk, and how we use it. So our enterprise vision and monitoring, what do we want to achieve? Well, actually, we think it's an illusion that you can produce applications that are 100% okay all the time. So we don't believe that we can be error-free in the near future. But what we do want to achieve is that errors or abnormal behavior of the systems, of the applications, must be detected very fast, and we need the data to correct that system or that application before our customers knows it. So basically that is why we are doing this. And the other thing is that we also want to have an efficient capacity planning. We need to know what's coming, what will be our resource usage within the next month, next year, to be as efficient as possible with our resources. So to achieve that enterprise vision, we adopted this maturity model, and we try to fill this in step by step within the Rabobank. And well, it is mostly about 5 levels, and I don't think there's a lot of rocket science behind it, because everyone who has done something in the past with problem determination starts doing this. You start gathering data. You ask yourself, what has happened? Why did it happen? And how can I prevent it? So that's basically the things we are working on. And our enterprise vision at this moment goes up to level 4. So we want to go up to level 4. And once we achieve that, once we can predict what is going to happen, I think we did quite a good job. And by that time, we also believe that we can take the last step, because then the technology is that far that we can take that step. So if you want to achieve that, you have some challenges. You need data. You need data from all your core business processes and all your core environments. And you also need the ability to transform the data to information by which you can manage your core business functions. And looking at our platforms running with Rabobank, you can say that almost on every platform there are components, logical components, that do something with, let's say, infrastructure monitoring. Some components that do application performance monitoring. We also need an operation analytics platform to which you can send all the data from all the environments to. So you need some collector components on every platform in the business. On the right side, HP Nonstop is in a different color because we are migrating that out. And it will be gone within the next few years. We want to achieve this, but we get also some other requirements that absolutely it may not have no negative impact on our business functions. So the business must go on. So the performance must be guaranteed, the throughput must be guaranteed. We also don't want to recompile or change any application. And we don't always succeed in that, but we can get far with that statement. So we don't need to change applications. And of course, it must have minimal overhead in your overall resource consumption. So what did we do once we started with our journey to migrate our payment system to Linux and the mainframe? We put together all the stakeholders in the room and say we have to do something about monitoring, and in the broadest perspective, so infrastructure, application, business monitoring. And those stakeholders, they came up with the wildest ideas and really good ideas, but they always talked about the end situation. What do they want? And they wanted everything in at one time, and that was very difficult to achieve. So actually, we ended up with nothing. We discussed a lot, great ideas, but nothing came out of it. So, a year and a half ago, we started the same exercise and put the same people into the room and say, hold your thoughts, there were great ideas, but what is your biggest problem now? What keeps you awake today? And that, with that approach, we came up with the top 20 of topics we could take on. And then the next question was, if we can start small, wouldn't that be nice? And you keep keep the thought, think big, but start real small, in little steps, and fill in your end goal. So that is why, when the question was, when we get the question, how can we improve our robustness and our efficiency of the payment factory we are currently building now by deploying our monitoring step by step. So we start very small. So plotting the mainframe out of this picture brings us to our core, let's say our core architecture around monitoring. And we do have a number of tools in place already. We do have some tools for your infrastructure monitoring, like OmegaMon, Zeeware. We also have already tools for application performance monitoring, more or less. The applications itself start sending errors, write logs. And for the collector component, we were looking for a component, and IBM came up with a common data provider, and that is for us our central component by which we can select all the Z data that's around and stream it to our operation analytics platform, which is Splunk. Our infrastructure monitoring part was there already, but we don't get out of it. We don't get all the things out of it that we could get out of it. So we have a project running to further improve our infrastructure monitoring. Also, our application monitoring is a project that is running to improve that. And what we are talking here about is how can we connect our operation analytics platform. To make the complete architecture for our System Z, of course, besides the core, we have to connect to our current incident and operation management environment. We do need to fulfill the requirements of our business and the risk and compliance. So actually, this is it. This is all about our architecture. And common data provider and Splunk is where we are talking about today. We came up with a roadmap. As I said just before, in the meeting with those stakeholders, there was a top 20 list. And what we saw is that the most of the requirements that the people had was reducing costs, improving availability, and all that kind of things, improving the performance. So it automatically gave us a way to prioritize what we were going to do first. So we came up with this high-level roadmap, and we started with common data provider and Splunk, because we believe that all those top 20 issues can be solved with those components in place. So that brings us to the common data provider and Splunk. Yep.
So then, as Harry mentioned, one of the things that they really needed to go and get access to was IBM mainframe data into Splunk. So the solution and being the longtime partner that Rabobank had, it was obvious for us the easy way for them to go and do that. We've had experience since it's IBM's mainframe for decades on how to go and collect and get access to all of the Z operational data in near real time. So our common data provider is our solution to stream that data as soon as we can grab access to it into Splunk. We've been working with Splunk for quite some time. It's been a great partnership. We've gone and you know, we're happy here to speak at their event. They've been to some of our share conferences or ZTechU's and really talked about the partnership and why it's important. It's really about gaining access and visibility into mainframe. Just making it sort of, it's not that isolated black box, helping Harry come out of the basement, right? So he's mentioned that folks are sitting down in the basement on Z. It's just something that's not understood when we go and talk to a lot of our customers, or especially their lines of business. They know that the mainframe's there and it's important, but they don't have visibility into it. And that's really where the solution around our common data provider really is born. It's a really powerful tool. It's very flexible. The next slide I hear is actually a simplified architecture picture that we have that goes and talks about how to go and pull data from a variety of sources. It'll take the widest range of SMF records, so all of the known and standard IBM types from the KIX 110 transaction records, DB2, SMF80, RFF security records. Also, we support a lot of the very key third-party types, so we know that security is a big focus for a lot of our customers, so CA Top Secret, ACF2, really a wide variety of Z operational data. So as we go in and collect that data, it's a lot of it's binary encoded in something that's been around for decades called EPSIDIC. So it's not something that's human readable. We'll take that data and transform it into something that's human readable. Do some data curation on that to really make it usable into Splunk. We also have some advanced filtering capabilities. where we can go and filter on specific data types, right? So if we want to, for example, just take part of an SMF record, we can go and just do a quick update and just say, let's just take these 12 fields and we'll just send that data, because Z data can be very voluminous, right? Some of our medium to bigger customers will easily generate 5-10 terabytes of data a day just from their mainframe operations environment. So we can go in and filter down into specific records or certain parts of records. And we even have, as part of our system data engine, a way to go and filter for specific conditions now as well. So we worked with another bank, another partner bank in the US. They had a use case where they just wanted to bring some of their KIX transaction records up into Splunk. So, but specifically the ones that were transactions that ran longer than 2 seconds or ended in admin. So really things that would start to impact their business, they wanted to bring up and service to kind of their enterprise IT ops. So it's a really flexible tool to go and do that. So one of the great things we got out of partnering with Splunk is what's the best way to bring this kind of volume of data from a single device into Splunk. So this is where we kind of came up with the architecture to have a data receiver and Splunk ingestion app to pull all of those different data types and records. And the reason we did that is we really focus on optimizing for performance in our comm data provider. So like Harry said, one of the key things that they had to do is it couldn't impact their business, right? They had to have low overhead. So it's something that we've kind of maniacally focused on is performance in our comm data provider. So we do this so that we can ingest as much data from the mainframe as possible in a condensed format. But with our data ingestion app, we can go and annotate and make that data very usable. So it's, if you go and look at an SMF record in Splunk that comes from, it's very well formatted. You can go and click, and it's very easily readable. So the other key thing that we have with our CDP is, and one of the reasons why we have Harry here is we have a process called IBM Design Thinking where we work very closely with our customers as sponsor users, right? So we're building these tools for him and to make his life easier. So we go and we think about questions like, you know, what are they thinking? What is their what are they trying to accomplish? What are they feeling when they're trying to do this? And really build the solutions around our key personas and key users as we go and build our tools. So this is kind of what our comm data provider configuration looks like. All of our data sources and data types are very well segmented. So if you need security data, you just drill down and say, okay, I need the security records, go and check those and those. If I want my KIX records, I can go down and filter out on the subtypes, easily select those, and then again add those key informations. And then you can one or more targets on where you want to send that data to. So we have customers that have multiple Splunk instances in their environment, so they want a certain subset of data to go to Splunk Enterprise Security, right, where they don't want that broader set of data to go to their enterprise ops. So CDP is from one UI, can go and select all those different data types and pick where you want that data to go. And the picture that's there is actually a screen capture that Harry gave me from his environment, just picking a wide variety of data types and data records to really drive what they're doing with their business. So next I'll let Harry go ahead and talk about what they're doing within their Splunk environment.
Thank you. This is a slide I stole from the presentation of Rabobank given last year at the Splunk conference. What we see is that last year and a half, and I think, well, Joop is in the audience, but our Splunk team can say that we are growing very fast with Splunk. The number of, I think, I don't know what the figures are now, but I wouldn't be surprised if they are doubled or tripled, or I'm not sure. So we are growing fast. This is the common data provider Splunk setup we use. On the left side, there is the mainframe. We, as Dan just showed, you can very easily configure what type of data you want to stream and forward to Splunk. On the ZOS side, there is a data streamer, this, the component that captures the data that you have configured in your policy file that should be captured. It streams it to our Linux environment on which our Splunk forwarders are running. On that environment, a common data provider data receiver is active. That receives the stream data and produces files. And there is also a Splunk CDP ingestion app that handles those files and will transform them in a way that they can be nicely indexed and nicely searched on. So, no rocket science here, very simple configuration, very simple implementation. Well, let's try to do some demo.
Yeah, so we had put these slides in place, not thinking we were going to go in and do a demo, but we'll go ahead and switch the video monitor here and go over to Harry's laptop.
So I wasn't allowed you to show our production data from our mainframes, but we do have some POC environment where we
might
have...
need to keep it on the same.
So let's start very soon. Oh, by the way, if you look at this one, this is our Splunk proof concept environment. IBM also has, together with the common data provider, it also provides a CDP Splunk app. Once you installed, your common data provider starts streaming data and you download the app from the Splunk base, you can get your first dashboards without coding anything yourself, so it's pretty nice, and they are further improving it. Let's go to our POC environment and start with the more simpler things. This is a screen that shows something about our security, about our logon attempts, and I don't think we are going to use this one because we have better tools for this, but I would like to show, because I get sometimes a question on how fast is it, how fast is the data streamed to Splunk. And what you see here that there are 7 logon failures with one user. Probably he tried it. I know Hank van Malsen is my colleague. And we worked together very hard on the CDP, and he's watching us now to see if everything goes okay. So let's switch to this log on screen. If, well, this is how we log on our mainframe, and it's exciting. So if you're not a mainframer, I think you drop everything and run to us. But let me try to just log on with the non-existing user ID A, B, C, D. So, mainframe says it's not authorized to use it. If I go back to...
And this is also one of the reasons why we like to visualize Zdata in Splunk as well. I know the mainframers love the green screens, but I know a lot of folks would really prefer it in a Splunk dashboard.
So So if I go back to the Splunk dashboard, you see that there is a user ABCDEF that has tried to log in. So that's about the speed you get your data in Splunk once you catch it with CDP. Well, some basic things from an infrastructure perspective. Once you start streaming SMF data, you can do anything with it. You can start seeing how your usage of the system is. What's your, if you're hitting the defined capacity, how many crypto card calls were done in the last 10 minutes. So a lot of these stuff, you can really start building very fast. One of the interesting things for us was what is our top 20, top 10 CPU using jobs, CPU using programs. Well, you have it almost immediately. If you start streaming the data, you can build this and you have it. And the nice thing about this is you can start collecting history. And you can see what the trends are. You can see if there's an application that suddenly starts to use much more CPU as it did before. So so that this is nice. Most of our sysproc says, well, I'm not excited about it. It's nice visualized, but I do have my OmegaMon. I do have my own tooling. I do have my own reporting. So they found it nice, but they were not that excited. So I think when it becomes a very, very much powerful is when, well, let me go to our data power environment. What we have is in front of our mainframes, we have a security gateway, and we implemented that with data power. With data power, we can feed the log files also to Splunk. So we get a nice view of what's happening, what's coming in and out of our mainframes. What are the requests coming in and out of the mainframes? How is the load balancing? This gives us an idea about the load balancing because we load balance it about two different data centers. And so when something is wrong with the load balancing, we can put an alert on it and act immediately on that. So and this is something about our web service we have running and the number of requests. If I go to the details from data power, I can say, hey, there's, this is not, I should have split this screen in an inbound and an outbound service request because everything that goes in and out the mainframe goes to these data powers. And what you see here is that this is an outbound service. Well, I know it because this is an outbound service, but there's also an inbound service that has exactly the same number of requests, so there's an overlap. So that's why I had to split this. I must split this. But the nice thing is that if I drill down to that service, get balances 04, it was, what happens in that service, it shows here our average response time. It's about 23 milliseconds. What this service does, because we are still in a migrating phase, it has to get still some data from our HP non-sub systems. So this service has an elapsed time on average of 23 milliseconds, but it also does an outbound call to the get balances overview. So that also costs 10 milliseconds. So once we migrated everything to the Z environment, we can reduce those 23 milliseconds with another 8 or so milliseconds. And that sounds peanuts, but these are services that are called really thousands of times a second. So every millisecond counts. Looking at, so now we can start combining the data. So if we go back to the screen. No, wrong one. And nice thing is, once you have the data, you can do anything without it. So I almost say your own brain is become your own imagination. Your own brain becomes a limited factor. But what I did here is just get an infrastructure picture of our, well, these are our mainframes. We have KIX regions running in there, the inbound regions, the AORs, our application regions. outbound regions, and you can see the same picture as you saw right now, that there is the data powers are running. So there comes traffic in the mainframe and goes traffic out of the mainframe, and you just start somewhere, and you start filling in the picture. So now our next step will be just to see what's flowing through these environments. We can extend it with, these are all applications that do requests. And all the requests, outbound requests, go to other applications. So you can start really building up an end-to-end picture. So this is from an infrastructure point of view. I also started just before this session a test run, and I hope I configured it to run about an hour. So what we do is we are migrating from HP Nonstop to ZOS, and we can do anything at once. So the first step is we migrate. Now let's say we try to fill our DB2 databases and do our inquiry services on the mainframe and still keep the payment initiations, so the account entries, inserts on the HP Nonstop. So you do a payment initiation that is inserted on the HP Nonstop system. It is replicated to ZOS into the DB2, and you can get your balances. All our services get balances are now running on ZOS. So you can imagine that replication process must be fast, because if I want to transfer money, if I do a payment order, and I want to check my balance, or I want to check my entries, it must be there. If that replication process runs behind, you have to act immediately. So that is what we are trying to do there. So this is a delay from one, this is the peak from something more than a second. That is acceptable. But when you get to 2 seconds or 3 seconds, you must be alerted. Okay. Get order to move fast. This is a picture about the number of account entries that passes, the service units that were used, and the service units per booking. This is another one that says something about every detailed CSS transaction that has run. You can see what the service units per booking were, what the total service units, NQ calls, DBQ calls. And the nice thing of this, we now also already use this for our developers already. So what we also try to do is predict before where there's any line of code written, is try to predict what that code is going to do. What is the resource usage of that code? Is it acceptable? How much does it cost? And the business can accept it before you even coded one line of that into that application. And what we see now is that our developers, when they are unit testing their application, they are immediately looking at what is my service unit used? What did it cost? And they can check whether it was within the boundaries that we predicted. If it's okay, they can go on. If it's not okay, they can get back to the drawing board or get back to the business, because your application is going to cost much more than we predicted. Now let's go where we're here for. So the applications. So infrastructure application, but this is really nice. I'm very impressed myself about what the Splunk team here made, and they visualized it in a very simple way. But this is one of our most important business functions for the future, called instant payments. To be short, what we trying to achieve within the Dutch. Between the Dutch banks is that we want to transfer money from one account to another account within 5 seconds. And within the European banks, we want to do that within 10 seconds. And that means, and the expectation of our banks is that this will become the new normal. So you can imagine that you really need to check the health of that end-to-end chain. You have to react immediately if there's a hiccup. And this is really a nice visualization. It takes you all in one picture. It shows you the health of the business function. It shows you what's happening in the different levels and different steps of your business function, and this is really what your applications are about. And this is also the really nicest thing for me about entering or streaming the data to Splunk, because we can almost make a quiz out of this. But which one of which of these bullets are mainframe applications, which are Linux applications or Windows applications? So you can't see the difference anymore. So now we are really integrated in the end-to-end chain, and that's really nice, I think.
So Harry, just a quick question. I know we had in our discussion. So when you built this, this was really helping you in your operations. But did you get requests from other parts of your business to have access and visibility into that?
Yeah, this is a dashboard I didn't build. This is the Splunk team, and really they did a really good job visualizing it. Almost everyone wants it. So the business people are asking for this because they have a view in one glance how their business functions are running. It is intended for use in the control room, but people who want to drill down, the SMEs are just, everybody wants to use it. So.
Yeah, so it's nice that they built something for kind of one purpose, but once, you know, it kind of takes off and everyone wants visibility into that. So from the business layers down to the subject matter experts that we have on Z.
Well, I think I'm out of time. I think most of this I already said in my presentation, but before we were able to be part of that end-to-end situation, we weren't able to get an end-to-end picture. And what you often saw was that everybody says, well, my application runs okay, and the other says, well, my application runs okay. So nobody actually saw what's happening in the system, and sometimes even what seems to be a very small disturbance in an application disrupted the whole business process. And now, by bringing that all together, we can now do really end-to-end monitoring and act on that. Well, what's next? We are further extending the use of CDP and Splunk and starting to do something with machine learning, artificial intelligence. If you need more information, there are a lot of links to more information. So if there are no more questions...